welcome back to WeConnect. Can I openly say that a movement like this, Chola Mandal itself, caters only to the very, very, very good artists and the good sculptors. What about the people who are unsung? What about the people who are unknown? What are you as a senior sculptor doing for these people?
The concept of Chola Mandal has really not been understood by many people. See, it was got together by about 30, 40 people, and they said, once we graduate from the College of Art, it's very difficult to continue painting. You need the proper atmosphere. And so let's have a village where, till we die, we can paint happily. That was the whole thing. So we didn't want to start a school. We didn't want to encourage artists. That was not the idea. It was to paint unhindered in a lovely atmosphere. That was the whole idea, to develop your art.
Right. But you also have visiting artists and visiting sculptors who come here. And is that the way that you actually encourage them to actually come and sit here? Tell me about that.
We have artist studios, and young artists come stay there for about 11 months. And if they continue staying in Chola Mandal for a year, they can also exhibit in our gallery. We give that stipulated period of a year to see that they are serious artists, not somebody coming, visiting for 2-3 days, then saying, I want my work in your gallery. No, we want to see how serious the man is. So that if he stays for a year, yes, we allow him to win. So we have got 5 or 6 artists here in the gallery who are all not members, but who have been staying in Chola Mandal. And eventually, 2 of them also bought land at Chola Mandal.
Okay, right. Art, food, money, probably all of this go hand in hand.
Yeah.
So how does a place like Chola Mandal actually sustain itself financially? I do think you've got 2 other art galleries that are open to visit, exhibitions.
Yes,
and things like
we
that.
Have 2 galleries called Laburnum and Indigo.
Mm-hmm.
And those were again built by art lovers who have given a donation to start these wings. And so any artist can come and show, and we charge a very basic minimum like any other gallery in the city, but we don't take a percentage. So the entire, if there is any sale, 100% of the amount goes to the artist. We don't charge any commission.
Right. What do you think is the acceptance of our South Indian artists outside of this circle of Chennai, outside of this country?
See, geographically, the Chennai is really quite far away from the north. And like all other fields, take journalists, take writers, take even filmmakers. How many of them are really known up north? Mm. One is the question of language. Nobody watches a Tamil film. But that doesn't mean that there is no great film being done.
But art has no language, so
it has no language. But again, the question of when you see a work of art, you have to see it 100 times before you really get to know the person. And so there's very little viewing on a day-to-day basis because you're 3,000 miles away. So unless you have regular shows in Bombay or Delhi every 3 months, which is very difficult, some of us try to do it every 6 months, but even then that's too little. So it takes more time to build up a reputation.
Right.
But that doesn't mean that the artists are anyway inferior here.
Absolutely.
No, absolutely.
Most definitely. What about art collectors, Nandu? Do you find in your experience that you have art collectors who will come down here and say, I like this work, I like that work, that's what I'll have in my drawing room?
Yes.
Do you find that, is there an increased awareness, is there an increased interest in artists from this part of the country?
See, the last 5 years has seen the bludgeoning of a lot of art buyers, young people buying art. But with the depression which we saw in the economic state, that has come down a little bit. But for serious painters, people who have been working for many years, the demand is still there. Maybe the collectors would say, maybe I'll buy it for 30% less. They're demanding this because economy in a way is a little bit dull in India right now. But definitely there is a market now. So artists can live on art. If you're fairly good and you're fairly known, you can live on your art like we have proved it at Chola Mandal.
But you, of course, had the advantage of being your father's son, and so therefore you came into a structure that was already pretty well established.
Yes.
If you talk about the Government Arts College here in Chennai itself, it's gone through tremendous upheavals in the recent past.
Yes.
So how is that going to actually stabilize itself at some point of time? Because it's a very respected, reputed place.
Exactly. Now you had principals like D.P. Roy Chaudhary. My father was there for 10 years. I think in an art school, what many very few people realize is, it's not the number of the staff that you have, it's the head that counts. If you have a fantastic principal, everything is solved. And everything has to be on talent, nothing else. If you do that, I think there's a chance that you can resurrect this place.
Nandu, let me now come to where we started about the art, the movement itself, the Madras movement, concentrating a lot online where you talked about mathematics and other things. Explain this to me again, please.
Yeah. See, one of the things which I didn't really mention was frontality, which was in the Madras movement, which was a very key factor. In the sense, if you take the gamut of Indian sculpture, 90% of Indian sculpture has been bas relief.
Right.
You don't go behind the image. It's from front. If you take
right.
the Arjuna's penance.
Yes, the Mahabalipuram, all the...
It's
yes,
bas right. relief. So when the sculptors in the Madras movement started, most of them took sheet metal, which itself lends itself beautifully to frontality, because you don't bend it around. You work in a very frontal manner. It's not a relief. It's not kept on the wall. It's kept away from the wall, but it's not a relief. It's almost 3/4 round. And like the late eminent critic Joseph James used to always say, he used to say, when I see your sculpture, it's like a skin peeled off a third dimensional sculpture and put on one plane.
Okay.
You know, you peel it off of a third dimensional sculpture and lay it flat on one plane. So you see it all in from one, the whole thing which you okay. otherwise had to go around, you see from one place. You know, there was a very banal, thing. Michelangelo used to say that you have 8 different ways you can see a sculpture. I used to always say, fine, you've got 8 ways to see a sculpture. But finally, when a sculptor takes a photograph of his sculpture, he has one view which he feels is
yes,
his
best,
favorite.
His favorite view.
Favorite.
Yes.
So I used to wonder, it was a very silly thought of thing. I said, why work all around when you can...
Why not just give it to one? Yeah, fair enough, makes sense.
So, and the other thing was also maybe if you take Hindu iconography, maybe yes. it was you never went behind the image for purposes of any religion, you never went behind the image.
But
you
this
always...
is, but here, sorry to interrupt you, but here you're talking about your own work, right?
No, if you take most of the Madras,
most of the Madras
sculptors,
okay.
Janakiram,
okay.
Dhanapal, or anybody, it was always from the front. So
right.
that became, in a sense, a style. And in my own work, I would puncture holes in them, you know, to show that you can see the back. There is nothing at the back for you to go behind and see. And you had that in the kavachas in the temples,
right.
where you had just the body of the or the head of the sculpture, and you had a cloth. So you thought there was a whole sculpture, but there was only the body.
Yes.
Everything else was added on.
Right. Well, Nandu, we've admired your work for a long time. We are particularly thrilled to see this museum, and thank you so much for actually having us in here. But very quickly, and one very final question to you, is that you have now got a restaurant right here. So you are finally, in a way, incorporating what has always been your dream about gastronomy and art going together. So finally, it has come true.
It has come true. I would always tell people, when you want the best fish in town in London, you go to Tate Modern. So,
yeah.
it is a place where you have to have the best food. People enjoy food, go around, see the thing. Art is not some painful activity. It's something which is pleasurable. You eat something nice, you go around, enjoy a whole day.
Right.
So it's very important.
Right. Well, we'd like to thank you very much on that very nice note. Unfortunately, too early for us to go out and have a meal there. But Nandu,
thank you
so very much indeed. Appreciate your time and thank you for having us here. Well, that's all we have time for on WeConnect. So for the moment, take care and bye for now.